change in plans.
At Fidelity, a change in plans is always part of the plan.
Johnson & Johnson. BNSF Railway. Consumer Cellular. Financial services firm, Raymond James. The Candida Fund, committed to advancing restorative justice and meaningful work through investments in transformative leaders and ideas. More at CandidaFund.org. Carnegie Corporation of New York, supporting innovations in education, democratic engagement, and the advancement of international peace and security at Carnegie.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
The White House is issuing urgent calls to action tonight in the face of COVID-19's latest assault. The appeals come amid talk of reimposing restrictions. Amna Nawaz begins our coverage.
The Biden team today issued a sober warning and an urgent call for far more vaccinations as the number of Delta-related infections is rising around the country. Dr. Rochelle Walensky is the director of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention.
We are yet at another pivotal moment in this pandemic, with cases rising again and some hospitals reaching their capacity in some areas. We need to come together as one nation. The Delta variant is more aggressive and much more transmissible than previously circulating strains. It is one of the most infectious respiratory viruses we know of and that I have seen in my 20-year career.
As new cases of COVID surge, the Biden administration is maintaining its mask guidance.
There has been no decision to change our mask guidelines. If any decisions about public health would be driven by the CDC. But of course, we are engaged with public health experts and the CDC about how to continue to attack the virus. And we've never said that battle is over. It's still ongoing.
The seven-day average of new cases in the U.S. is up 53%. 83% of cases are now comprised of the Delta variant. And three states, Florida, Texas, and Missouri, account for 40% of all new cases nationwide. Hospitalizations and deaths are still a fraction of what they were at their peak due to vaccinations, which experts say also protect against the Delta strain. Last night, President Biden urged the public to get inoculated at a CNN town hall.
If you're vaccinated, you're not going to be hospitalized, you're not going to be in an ICU unit, and you're not going to die. So it's gigantically important that you act like we all act like Americans or care about our fellow Americans.
As U.S. officials attempt to ramp up the vaccine effort, the effort to investigate the virus's origins also continues. On Capitol Hill, some Republican lawmakers also spoke of the need for vaccines, but they focused more of their attention on China and questions that remain over how the virus first spread in 2019.
We brought in medical experts from around the country, and it was very, very eye-opening to see what they said. Every one of those medical doctors testified that the virus likely started in the Wuhan lab. Everybody in America ought to be concerned about those findings.
While some public health experts say there's not enough evidence to support the lab leak theory, the Biden administration has said the idea and evidence should be investigated further. Last week, the World Health Organization backed that too. But today, China rejected the idea entirely.
To be honest, when I first saw the WHO's second phase of an investigation into the origin of the coronavirus, I was very surprised. I feel the plan disregards common sense and defies science.
The U.S. and other governments say more information from China is needed to prevent the next pandemic, even as the work to contain this one is far from over.
We take a deeper dive now on the Biden administration's efforts to combat the Delta variant with Surgeon General Dr. Vivek Murthy. Dr. Murthy, welcome back to the NewsHour. Always good to have you here. Help us understand now, this is confusing for a lot of people. We know that masking helps to contain virus spread. So why not change the masking guidance so that more people wear them now?
Well, it's a great question, Amna. So let's review what we know. We know, yes, that masks are helpful in preventing spread, but we also know from the science that the CDC shared about 2 months ago, is that if you are fully vaccinated, your risk of getting sick or transmitting the virus is low. Now, there are circumstances where individuals may want to consider wearing masks, where counties may decide to put mitigation measures like mask requirements back in place. And those would be, for example, if they had a lot of virus circulating, as some communities do. If you're an individual who maybe has kids at home who are not vaccinated, or you yourself are immunocompromised. Those are all circumstances where counties or individuals may decide that they want to wear masks again. I actually think that in a moment like this, when we're seeing COVID spreading so widely because of the Delta variant, that it's prudent to err on the side of caution, because again, a lot of people are getting infected right now, primarily unvaccinated. But again, bears being cautious, depending on your situation.
So what do you do about areas that where you have leaders, where there's a large amount of COVID and spreading right now? Florida, for example, where you're joining us from, has one of the highest COVID rates in the country. Governor DeSantis has said he opposes any mask mandates, especially when school restarts this fall. What do you do about those areas?
Well, what I can just tell you from a public health and science perspective is what we've learned, which is that the masks help. And that especially when you've got a lot of virus spreading and you don't have high vaccination rates, which is the case in parts of my home state of Florida, that masks absolutely can be a useful tool. And look, I understand that people are tired, you know, of so much of what we've dealt with over this past year, wearing masks, not seeing your friends, just going through the uncertainty of COVID. It's been exhausting for all of us. And we've made a lot of progress, but this is one of those moments, Amna, with the Delta variant spreading so quickly, that we've got to take measures to reduce spread. And vaccination is important. Like, we've got to vaccinate people quickly. But if you're trying to reduce spread in a short time frame, in the order of days to weeks, then it is measures like masking and distancing that are among our most powerful tools.
But Dr. Murthy, the Delta variant was spreading back in mid-May, back when the CDC chose to relax that masking guidance. In hindsight, looking back now, was that a mistake? Did that send the wrong message that we were past the worst of it too soon?
Well, I think the CDC made that decision because at the time, the cases were actually dropping significantly. The science was telling us that fully vaccinated people were, in fact, quite well protected. Nothing's 100%, but that the risk of infection and transmission was low. And I think what the CDC was also seeing at that time was, yes, there was Delta, but it was at very, very low levels at that time. What we've seen since then is Delta has really surged. It's more than 83% of cases that we're diagnosing of COVID right now. But what the CDC is also saying here is not that people shouldn't wear masks, but what they did 60 days ago is give counties and individuals the flexibility to determine when they use masks based on their risk tolerance and based on how much infection was in their community. Now, one of the things that we're seeing is as our vaccinated population is increasing, we're seeing COVID become a more local and regional phenomenon. The whole country is not flaring at once, but we are seeing rises and surges in pockets where the unvaccinated population is high. I think it makes sense to direct mitigation measures to those areas. And for counties that are putting mask measures in place because they see infections rising, I think it's a very reasonable step to take.
So the vaccination rates have plateaued somewhat, right? We're about 500,000 or so a day. 56% of the eligible American population has now been fully vaccinated. So what for you is the goal? What percentage do we need to get at where you say we're at herd immunity, we have a more comfortable level now where that virus spread can slow?
Yeah, so Amna, this is like the million-dollar question. And I use the proof is in the pudding example, which is that I don't think there's a specific number that we're targeting, because quite frankly, we don't know what that number is, because it changes based on how contagious the virus is. And now we're dealing with the more transmissible variant, which means the quote unquote number you need to reach herd immunity is actually greater in terms of percentage of the population vaccinated. But here's how we'll know we got there. When cases come down and stay down for a sustained period of time, we will know that we're at the point where we've hit a good vaccination target. We are not seeing that yet in the country. And while some areas are actually doing pretty well that have greater than 80% vaccination rates, in many other parts of the country, we are seeing surges among the unvaccinated. Now, one really important point, though, that is I think we got to make sure everyone understands, is that the increases in cases we're seeing is not evidence that the vaccine doesn't work. Quite to the contrary, what we are seeing is that 99.5% of deaths from COVID now, 97% of hospitalizations, are among those who are not vaccinated, which means, again, if you are fully vaccinated, you are well protected against the worst outcomes, severe illness and death from COVID. That's why it's still so important for people to go out there and get vaccinated.
You have said repeatedly, officials have said repeatedly, you have to get the right messengers to those people who are unvaccinated. And recently, we've seen a number of Republican lawmakers in particular who were previously largely silent on vaccinations now publicly speak out and urge people to get vaccinated. But we are still, in terms of our vaccination rates, now lagging other countries that we were once far ahead of. So is all of that a sign that even that messaging shift isn't really going to make a difference?
Well, I think every person who speaks up influences the people who believe in them. And I think seeing more political leaders step up to do that, seeing leaders in business and in education step up, seeing faith leaders increasingly step up in their communities to talk about the importance of getting vaccinated, I think this is actually very promising. Now, it takes people a little bit of time to absorb those messages and then to make the decision to get vaccinated. Once they get vaccinated, it takes several weeks for them to actually increase and get the protection that they need from the virus. But I think this is overall very encouraging. This is what we need to keep doing more of. The thing to remember here is that as powerful and as important as doctors and nurses are as messengers, we actually have recent data that tells us that all of us, family members and friends, can be powerful messengers as well. 1 in 5 of people who were on the wait and see category, if you will, as far as vaccines are concerned in January, made the decision to get vaccinated and got vaccinated. And when asked what changed their mind, they said it was talking to their family, to their friends, seeing their family and friends get vaccinated and do well. So I say that to remind everyone that in this phase of the vaccination campaign, it is up to us to also talk to our family and our friends, those who trust us, ask them if they got vaccinated. And if they haven't, have them go to vaccines.gov to find a place, help them answer questions. But we've got to help each other get vaccinated. That's how we're going to end this pandemic once and for all.
Dr. Murthy, lastly and briefly, if I may, you have said that the social media companies, the tech companies you've been in touch with need to do more to stop the misinformation that's out there and keeping people from getting vaccinated. What specifically else do you want them to do that would help to end the pandemic sooner?
Well, the reason I issued a Surgeon General's advisory on health misinformation last week and called on technology companies and other stakeholders to do more is because health misinformation is harming our health. It's all of us have we deserve to be able to make the right decisions for ourselves based on accurate information. A lot of people don't have that. There are 8 things that we laid out for technology companies to do, but a few that I'll mention to you here are: number one, acting more quickly to get disinformation reduced on their site. Number two, changing their algorithm so they don't continue to serve up more and more misinformation to people encounter it for the first time. And third is being more transparent with their data so we understand how much misinformation is actually being transacted on their site. When they say we've removed X number of pieces of misinformation, that doesn't mean much if we don't know, how many actually existed on the site. 4 million out of 4 billion is very different from 4 million out of 5 million. So we need more transparency. We need them to make more product changes to reduce the spread of misinformation. They have the ability to do that. We just need them to act with greater urgency because lives depend on it.
That is the U.S. Surgeon General, Dr. Vivek Murthy, joining us tonight. Dr. Murthy, always good to see you. Thanks for the time.
Great to see you, Amna. Take care and be well.
I'm Stephanie Tsai with NewsHour West. We'll return to Judy Woodruff and the rest of the show after these headlines. Daily COVID deaths could triple by the fall, according to new projections. The COVID-19 Scenario Modeling Hub, which works with the CDC, offers 4 scenarios based on how many people are vaccinated and how fast the Delta variant spreads. Under the most likely scenario, the U.S. is projected to get to a 70% vaccination rate, which could mean a peak in October of 850 deaths a day. The U.S. Justice Department announced the formation of strike forces to target gun crimes. They'll be based in New York, Chicago, Los Angeles, San Francisco, and Washington, D.C. Deputy Attorney General Lisa Monaco said the focus is on gun violence and gun trafficking.
We all know that our job is to go after those who pull the trigger and end up critically injuring and in some cases murdering innocent people. But our job is also, of course, to go after the sources of those guns, the corridors that they travel in, and the networks that feed those guns.
Later, Attorney General Merrick Garland met with police in Chicago just hours after mass shootings in the city that killed three people and wounded nearly 20. Fire crews in the western U.S. are finally getting help from the weather against the giant bootleg fire in southern Oregon. As of today, some 2,200 firefighters had the wildfire about one-third contained. But elsewhere, the Tamarack fire that originated in northern California has crossed into Nevada, forcing new evacuations. Disagreement over investigating the January assault on the U.S. Capitol by Trump supporters continues. On Wednesday, the Speaker of the House of Representatives, Nancy Pelosi, barred two Republicans from an investigative committee, both of them Trump allies. Republican leader Kevin McCarthy then withdrew his other nominees. Neither side backed down today.
The American people want to know the truth. And in light of statements and actions taken by them, I could not appoint them.
It doesn't matter today what she does with that committee, because it's not going to change the outcome of what it seems like a predetermined or already written report.
Pelosi insisted the select committee will do its job even if Republicans boycott. McCarthy said the GOP might mount its own probe, although it has no power to do so under House rules. The U.S. Capitol Police have named J. Thomas Manger as their new chief. He takes charge of the department that was overwhelmed in the January 6th assault on the Capitol. The House came together today on giving refuge to more Afghans who worked with the U.S. military and faced threats from the Taliban. Lawmakers added another 8,000 visas to 26,000 allocated already. Meanwhile, the Pentagon confirmed a series of airstrikes targeted the Taliban this week. The militants have made sweeping gains in recent weeks. Cuba now faces U.S. sanctions over its violent crackdown on protests. Thousands of people demonstrated this month against food shortages, high prices, and pandemic restrictions. U.S. penalties announced today affect a Cuban military leader and a special security unit. It's a departure for President Biden, who once talked of liberalizing relations with the communist government. At the Tokyo Olympics, the director of tomorrow's opening ceremonies was fired after reports that he joked about the Nazi Holocaust in 1998. A musical composer for the Games had already stepped down over bullying classmates at school, and the head of the Tokyo Organizing Committee resigned weeks ago over sexist remarks. Today, organizers acknowledge the scandals have plagued their efforts.
I am very keenly aware of my responsibility, the fact that so many problems have been uncovered one after another, and that we have to deal with them, leaves the public with the impression that we are responding too late. We deeply regret this.
Separately, First Lady Jill Biden arrived in Tokyo today, leading the U.S. delegation. She was welcomed by Japan's prime minister. And we now have results of today's U.S. softball game. The top-ranked Americans defeated Canada 1-0 for their second win in as many games. The National Football League announced new COVID rules for the 2021 season. Teams with outbreaks among unvaccinated players will forfeit games that cannot be rescheduled before the season ends. Players from both teams will not be paid for the canceled contest, and the team responsible for the outbreak will cover the other team's financial losses. And the NBA champion, Milwaukee Bucks, got their victory parade today. Players and members of the organization rode in double-decker buses as thousands of fans cheered them in downtown Milwaukee. The Bucks beat Phoenix Tuesday night for their first title in 50 years. Still to come on the NewsHour, migrants crossing the sea to Greece face harsh moves by the Coast Guard to repel them. We meet the Iowa teen behind an innovation to detect infection in stitched wounds. Plus, a new book details the inner workings of Facebook and its ambitions.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
A bipartisan group of senators is still negotiating the details of an infrastructure bill after a procedural vote to start debate failed yesterday. They say they're making progress and hope to have the details by early next week. The biggest sticking point in negotiations remains how to pay for it. The $1.2 trillion framework includes about $600 billion in new spending. That money would go toward public projects like shoring up roads and bridges, expanding broadband, and investing in electric vehicles. Democrats are also planning a separate $3.5 trillion spending bill. For more on where infrastructure stands, I'm joined by Republican Senator Shelley Moore Capito of West Virginia. She led a separate bipartisan effort on infrastructure last month. And Senator, welcome back to the NewsHour. We appreciate your joining us. So we know you're not part of this group that's negotiating the current plan, but is it your sense that there will be an agreement in coming days that both parties can sign on to?
You know, I think that the efforts that the bipartisan group has put forward has been very straightforward and very honest, very narrow in terms of a physical infrastructure, much like the package that I was negotiating with more dollars into it. I do expect that early next week, hopefully as soon as Monday, that they will have actual bill text so we would know what we would be voting on. May take a couple days to work it through the system and maybe even another week. But I do think that they are going to be able to lay the last issues to rest and bring forward a bill, and then we can make the judgments on it when we see it.
And, of course, we'll be watching very closely for that. But this has been, as you suggest, in the works for weeks and weeks, even months. It is taking a long time. Much of the hang-up has been over how to pay for it. Democrats say that Republicans have repeatedly said no to ideas like putting more money into the IRS to go after tax cheats. And what's reported right now is that Republicans are looking at something called rolling pharmaceutical rebates. But we know this would only pay for a fraction of the cost. So where would the money come from?
Well, we have to look at it. Certainly the base of what goes forward and paying for any kind of infrastructure is the gas tax. But we know that falls short in terms of meeting the demands of where we are. So I think that this group has worked, as I did, worked with the White House to try to get the White House to reprogram some COVID dollars, a lot of COVID dollars that are not, that are either going unspent or are found that they really, since we're coming out of this pandemic, are not going to be able to use in the right times. That may, you know, it sounds like a little, but it's really hundreds of billions of dollars. You know, we did not want to, we as Republicans did not want to touch the 2017 tax cuts because we think they've been very successful in spurring the economy. The president himself did not want to ask users of electric vehicles to pay into any kind of user fee. They use the roads, they don't pay. So we had a bit of a disconnect there. I think both sides are trying to get to reasonable pay-fors, but I expect in the end it's going to be tough to meet all the challenges of the pay-for. I guess the question will be, is enough of it paid for, and will the economic growth take care of the shortfall? And people are going to have to answer that for themselves.
Why have Republicans mainly opposed the idea of giving the IRS more money to go after tax cheats?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think because the overhang of some IRS issues that we had with the IRS targeting conservative groups, I think we saw tax returns from the wealthiest individuals just all of a sudden, you know, public information. Where did that come from? That has to be some sort of a leak. So I think these things feed on each other, and the trust of the IRS coming knocking at your door. The other thing is the parameters of which the Democrats set forward in terms of getting to the president told me $700 billion. I think he came off that figure, but would be that banks would share records, would be that your accountant would share records. You know, are we getting into a fine line of where we need to really invasion of privacy and privacy of financial records? These issues, I think, are very sensitive to us as Republicans. And I think in the end, the group knew that we wouldn't, to the amounts that they wanted, we couldn't go with the tax gap. So I expect that to be in their larger bill, in their $3.5 trillion larger bill.
Senator, you've expressed concern also about this infrastructure legislation being tied to this separate $3.5 trillion so-called reconciliation bill, what the Democrats are calling social infrastructure. But it is being described. Democrats are saying this is the most consequential piece of legislation for working families in modern American history. They talk about the money in there for home health care workers, for pre-K, for child care, for the poor, elderly. Why are these things not worth spending money on?
Well, we do now spend money on these things. I think, you know, I think these are discussions that we need to work through our committees. Do we need to increase? I believe home health care is something, after having my parents go through this, I realized the tremendous cost to families. These are issues that we need to work on together. We don't need to ram through. What I disagree with where the Democrats are going, they've set an amount. They've said, okay, we're going to spend $3.5 trillion, and then they're filling up the buckets. Shouldn't we be looking at the needs and then look at what the cost is? And so I think if we're going to make consequential, huge social reform all across this country, we should be doing that together. And it won't be that. It'll be singularly done. This was a huge tax increase on the American public, and it's also a lot of reckless spending going along with it.
But when you say there's already money, that the country, I mean, sorry, that the government is already spending money on these things like home health care, I mean, we hear from Democrats that's just not the case, that much, much more needs to be done.
I'm not saying that we're spending as much as we need to or that we're meeting the need. That's what I'm saying. Let's define the need. How much more do we need to spend? What will keep a senior in their home longer to be able to have home health care and not make a greater cost to Medicaid or to the family? These are the kinds of discussions we need to have.
Different subject quickly, Senator, yeah. And that is the federal government debt ceiling. The amount of money the government has to pay for its bills to keep running. This has typically been not a popular thing, but a necessary and a routine thing in order to keep the government open. However, the Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell is saying right now that all Republicans will vote against raising it. We know you voted for it. We looked it up three times under President Trump. Why would now be different?
Well, I think, I'll tell you what, the debt ceiling vote is always a difficult vote, and it's always has some source of controversy through the years, and I'm sure you know that, having covered it probably dozens of times. And I think what we need to look at is we've spent $1.9 trillion on a rescue package that we now see our communities flooded with money, and some of the money cannot be unspent, for instance, in the unemployment area because governors have pulled back on that. I think we see now a $1.2 trillion infrastructure package coming down the road. We now see a $3.5 trillion package coming down the road after that. I mean, I think at some point we've got to look at what impacts this is having on our whole finances in this country. The debt ceiling in all likelihood will be raised. It has every time in the past. We're not going to default on our responsibilities, but I think we need to look at the spending and find out who's it costing individuals and what's this do to future generations. That's the discussion we need to have.
Does it matter to you that the chief economist at Moody's, Mark Zandi, is saying that passing these two infrastructure bills, both social infrastructure and the other one, are going to boost the economy and reduce all the concerns about inflation? In other words, that the concern that there's too much spending is overdone.
Well, you know, I think, you know, I've been here for 20 years. We used to talk in billions. It's now trillions. Remember in 2010 when President Obama came forward with a $1 trillion package and we all about fell over. We're now up to almost $10 trillion. So, I mean, I think every economist has a different opinion. I have great respect for Mark Zandi. But I think you could find an economist who thinks differently, who thinks too much money is being flooded into the system.
Senator Shelley Moore Capito, we appreciate it. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Judy.
Greece has been accused of breaching international law with a new aggressive migration policy. Pro-refugee groups allege that the Greek Coast Guard is endangering the lives of migrants in the Aegean Sea by pushing them back towards Turkish waters. Critics also accuse the European Union of ignoring Greece's behavior 6 years into the migration crisis. We sent special correspondent Malcolm Brabant to the Greek island of Samos to investigate this latest snapshot of the desperate journey at the extreme edge of the European Union.
This is the Greek island of Samos, The mountains, a mile away across the sea, are in Turkey. Appearances are deceptive. These are not gentle waters. This is an alleged attempted pushback by Greece's Hellenic Coast Guard in June. The migrants told the Norwegian non-profit called the Aegean Boat Report that the Greeks removed the dinghy's engine and left, expecting them to float back to Turkey.
Pregnant woman, you are killing her here. Look at her here, this morning, keep her in the sun. No water, nothing, nothing. He will die with the baby and you will be happy. Right?
No, I'm not going to be happy.
And you will have family. And God will bless you because of your good job.
After the dinghy drifted for 17 hours, the Greeks relented and took the migrants ashore.
It's very rare to get the chance to talk to a pushback victim in Greece for the very reason that they've been pushed back. But we're on our way to see a pushback victim who's come from Central Africa. We're going down a very bumpy road. She was pushed back to Turkey, and then she managed to make her way back across the Aegean Sea here to Samos. We're going to see her outside the Samos refugee camp, which is extremely squalid, and it's guarded by police who are very hostile to journalists and their cameras.
Turkish Coast Guard footage shows a group of migrants, including the Central African woman, landing in Turkey after being rescued. This and other geolocated photographs prove she was on the Greek island of Lesbos. Our interviewee, who escaped conflict in her home country, doesn't want to be identified for fear of retribution. She picks up the story.
They took us up through the mountains and all around until we came to a port. We saw the big boat and we said, "Oh Lord, we're going back to Turkey." They put us on the boat. There were too many waves. They made us wear life jackets and said they might hit us again if we didn't get on the big boat. They threw us little crates of oranges. That was when Turkey came to rescue us.
The pushback happened under the cover of darkness. The woman and fellow migrants were taken eastwards from Lesbos and abandoned near Turkish waters in this dinghy, filmed by the Turkish Coast Guard.
We were in the raft for a long time. There were too many waves. People were screaming. It really affected me. I couldn't talk. I was too dehydrated. They abused us. They didn't respect us or anyone's human rights. I thought that if you come here to their country to request asylum, they'll listen to you. But they killed that.
This is what it's like to be cast adrift. Under international law, nations are obliged to help those in peril on the sea. According to the 1951 Refugee Convention, asylum seekers should not be expelled if their lives or freedom are threatened.
The life rafts that we've seen have no means of propulsion and are often hugely overloaded to the point where it's dangerous for them to be in those life rafts.
Former British Army officer Nick Waters is a digital analyst with Bellingcat, a website using open source information from the internet to expose international wrongdoing. Here, a Turkish drone captures a life raft, apparently being pushed back by a vessel from Greece's Hellenic Coast Guard.
There is no way for them to be crossing the Aegean in those kind of life rafts, and we believe that they're being put in those life rafts by the Hellenic Coast Guard.
Samos lawyer Dimitris Houlis represents asylum seekers. He accuses Greece of doing the European Union's dirty work.
They led them with no water, with babies. They put their lives in danger. Our Hellenic Coast Guards, that they are the people that do these crimes. Until 2 years ago, they were heroes. They were diving in the sea to save babies. We have seen the photos. They saved a lot of people. And suddenly, the same people, they're doing the worst thing that they can do for Greece.
Listen to the screams. And then the warning shots from the Greek patrol boat. This Turkish footage is part of a propaganda war against Greece. The two countries have been adversaries for centuries. Greece's migration minister, Notis Mitsotakis, declined to be interviewed. But in response to persistent allegations about pushbacks, he issued a video statement.
Turkey is a safe country and can provide, where needed, appropriate international protection. Sadly, instead of Turkey preventing unlawful departure, it is often too busy filming them.
6 years into Europe's migration crisis, Greece is exasperated that asylum seekers keep coming. But what about the pushbacks?
Allegations affecting Greece are clearly unfounded, rely on footage or testimonials provided for from the country of departure.
To be frank, some of the Greek government denials about events have been bordering on absurdity. It is inconsistent with the evidence that is available. I think it's worth noting that this is what we'd expect from a government like Russia, for example, but not from the government of a European country.
Greece is currently home for an estimated 120,000 asylum seekers. Most would prefer to be elsewhere, but are stuck here because the EU sealed its borders in 2015, after more than 1 million migrants managed to enter. Last week, centre-right Prime Minister Kyriakos Mitsotakis justified his tough migration policy.
Greece is committed to protecting its borders, which are also the borders of the European Union, while always, always ensuring full respect for human rights. And this, of course, includes intercepting attempted illegal crossings at sea.
Asylum seekers are well aware of Greece's stance, but appear undeterred by the threat of pushbacks or the living conditions on the Greek islands. This video appeal was sent to a pro-refugee non-profit on Saturday.
Hello. I would like to tell you that we have reached Samos Island. We have these kids, children. We are three adults and my wife, these children. Just we are calling you to save us as soon as possible, because these children are facing a problem since last night.
He wasn't the only one sheltering in the undergrowth.
We're still on Samos and we're on our way to see a Palestinian called Mohammed who's hiding out. Now, this young man, who is 25 years old, apparently swam all the way from Turkey to Samos over the weekend. But because it's the weekend, he can't get officially registered by the authorities, and he's afraid, as are non-profits, that he might be picked up and pushed back.
Mohammed, a telecoms specialist from Gaza, took 8 hours to swim across. He showed us bites he suffered while hiding in a forest.
I heard from a lot of people and friends that the Greek Coast Guard will catch them, put them back on the ship, and return them to the Turkish regional waters. They don't allow them to apply as refugees and don't grant them their legal rights.
Mohammed laid low until Monday, when, under the protection of the UN Refugees Agency, he was formally registered and admitted to the camp. From there, the Central African pushback victim urged the European Union to force Greece to adhere to the EU's core values.
Things have to change. There just needs to be an attempt to save people. There is too much risk on the water. It's not easy. They need to listen to people. They need to accept people instead of throwing them into the sea.
She has nothing to go back to. Her parents were killed and her African home was destroyed. Asylum is her only hope, but it's not guaranteed. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Malcolm Brabant on Samos.
All over the world, infections in the place where surgical incisions are made are a major cause of new illnesses, extended hospital stays, and even death. In the U.S. alone, these infections cost more than $3 billion annually. But in developing countries, those statistics are much worse. Stephanie Tsai reports on one scientist who's working on a more affordable way to detect these infections early. It's the latest in our series, Breakthroughs on the Leading Edge of Science.
The colorful one here is Prince.
And for the past year and a half, Deja Taylor has been developing a unique invention to detect infections after someone's had surgery.
I came up with color-changing stitches that provide early detection for infections, with a specific focus on surgical site infections in developing countries, because those can be very deadly if they're found too late.
How does it work?
When you have an infection, there's some chemical imbalances going on, and my stitches pick up those chemical imbalances and then they change color because of what's going on, all the science stuff.
The stitches change color.
The stitches change color.
She can't get too specific because of a pending patent application, but Taylor says she uses sutures dyed with beet juice to make the magic happen.
Beets are natural indicators. So a natural indicator is just a baseline term for a substance that changes color when the pH changes.
Healthy skin is naturally acidic, but if a surgical site gets infected, that acidity decreases. When that change happens, Taylor's sutures go from a bright red to a grayish purple color. By the way, Taylor is only 17.
Deja T. Taylor.
And she just graduated high school in June. Her path to these color-changing sutures began junior year in a chemistry honors class.
This is the room. This is where it all started.
After a suggestion from Taylor's teacher, Carolyn Walling.
She sat in the front row the very first day, and when I brought up, would anyone like to do a science fair project, she raised her hand immediately, and she stayed after school, and she said, let's talk about this.
I read an article about how these scientists created these stitches that involved this really fancy technology that I perceive to be inequitable to those that would actually be able to need this technology.
In low and middle income countries, 8 to 30% of procedures result in surgical site infections. But so-called smart stitches require smart devices, which are expensive.
I said, hey, I can do it better, and I can do it more equitable.
Issues of equity are personal for Taylor. She and her mother, LaDonna, live in the suburbs of Iowa City, a predominantly white area, and they have experienced their share of discrimination. Taylor says her previous school even tried to keep her from joining a science competition team. The lack of representation was even more apparent at her first science fair.
She looked around and she said, I am the only black person in this room. And that was like one of those things where maybe you know it, but you don't really notice it.
You've never experienced the world that way, obviously.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And she looked at me and she said, well, I'm going to win this thing.
And she did.
Deja helped open her teacher's eyes to racial discrimination, and from creating Black History bulletin boards in her elementary school to co-chairing her school district's equity advisory committee, Deja's been on a mission to educate those around her. She sees her invention as another tool in that mission.
So what did it feel like when you saw that this worked?
Yeah, I was like, oh my gosh, I did science. Like,
she'd be in my room constantly. It was probably every Friday after school. She was in here cutting up beets and boiling beets. It was a good probably 4 to 5 months that she was working on it.
And it paid off. And
my project is a novel suture additive.
This year, she was named a finalist in the prestigious Regeneron Science Talent Search, a national science competition for pre-college students. Past finalists include Nobel Prize winners and MacArthur Fellows.
From Iowa City, Iowa, please welcome 17-year-old Deja Taylor.
Taylor's work even landed her on the Ellen DeGeneres Show, where the host declared her the winner of the show's science fair, which, of course, is not really a thing.
That's a gorgeous trophy.
Yes, yes.
And all I had to do was come here.
Yeah.
Taylor's next big step, though, is college. In the fall, she heads to the University of Iowa.
I'll actually be majoring in political science, so really social sciences and getting in tune with that and creating this equitable plan on a greater scale.
And she's not done with her infection-detecting sutures yet. Taylor says she won't stop until the people who need the stitches have them.
What are you pinpointing as the challenge you're currently focused on?
So right now, it's just a pure focus of making this suture commercially viable so that everything can go smooth when everything goes to market and these stitches actually get to those developing countries.
There are still barriers to it being used in the real world, safe mm-hmm. to say.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
But do you consider it a success either way?
Yeah, because it works. It does detect pH. It does change colors where it needs to change colors. There are just some details that need to be worked out, but they're not insurmountable.
While many in the medical community have praised the invention, there is a technical obstacle, sterilizing the sutures. But she has already overcome a major hurdle, helping others that look like her believe they can find success in science too.
Knowing that I've inspired people all over the world is the real prize to me. That's the real recognition that, hey, I'm doing good in the world, and this isn't just for me. This project, this research, is quite literally outside of myself.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Stephanie Tsai in Iowa City, Iowa.
Facebook is under fire again for allowing misinformation around the coronavirus and vaccines to proliferate on its platform. As we've heard, the president and his team have ramped up their pressure on the company and other social media giants to combat false information. William Brangham looks at a new book that focuses on similar questions about Facebook's role, larger responsibilities, and its business.
The authors of this new book detail how Facebook has struggled and sometimes failed to curtail hate speech, disinformation, and violent rhetoric on its platform. It also examines how Facebook has become an enormously lucrative data mining operation, capturing the personal likes and dislikes of its users and serving them up to advertisers. The book is called An Ugly Truth: Inside Facebook's Battle for Domination, and it's written by two New York Times reporters, Shira Frenkel and Cecilia Kang. Welcome to the NewsHour. Good to have you both here. The title of your book comes from this memo that was written by a Facebook executive, where he's describing the company's mantra of how they connect people. And he writes in this memo about some of the possible dark sides of that connection. Maybe it costs someone their life by exposing someone to bullies. Maybe someone dies in a terrorist attack coordinated on our tools, and still we connect people. The ugly truth is that we believe in connecting people so deeply that anything that allows us to connect more people more often is de facto good. Shira, that's the essential tension in Facebook writ large, isn't it?
That's exactly right. And that's a pattern that we show through this book. And for us, it was one of the most powerful parts of writing this book, was discovering that over and over and over again, this company was essentially making a calculus that growth was the most important thing to it. Engagement, people coming on as often as possible. That's what matters. That's their bottom line. We can't forget this is a business that has to answer to its investors and to the stock market. And so all the decisions kind of stem from that central tension of needing to put, another part of the book says it well, I think, company over country.
Cecilia, Mark Zuckerberg's founding idea was this a free speech utopian idea that if in the presence of bad speech, quote unquote bad speech, more speech is the solution. But they quickly realized, the executives at Facebook, that lies and misinformation were what were percolating to the top, not countering those things. How did the company broadly react when they saw that that was what was so popular on the site? Mm-hmm.
Well, they have taken some efforts to try to clamp down on the spread of misinformation and harmful speech. But this is after many years of prioritizing speech that tends to be content that tends to be the most emotive, the kind of content that makes you respond, either by
an emotional reaction.
Absolutely, by either getting angry, by either getting fearful, and making you want to share and amplify. And this is a really important thing to note as we explore in this story about how the technology is used, the algorithms, to make that kind of content surface to the top. So what Facebook did is it hired lots of content moderators, and it tried to use artificial intelligence to try to find and weed out the worst speech. But by the time they did, and they had been warned so many times that this was a problem and they were acting very late, by the time they did, the problem was so enormous for them. And even the many thousands of content moderators that they had been hiring were playing catch up, and they were so far behind.
Cecilia, your book documents many instances where Facebook became aware of troubling things brewing and blossoming on their site. January 6th was a perfect example. Yeah. The election, the lies about it being stolen, and then the plotting that went forward leading up to January 6th. How did those people who came to DC use Facebook?
You know, journalists were seeing this happen in real time. They were seeing people on the far right, especially, organizing on Facebook right after the election. They were posting photos of arms, actually, and the kinds of rifles that they planned to bring with them to Washington. And they were warning Facebook. I mean, journalists like Shira were actually emailing Facebook and saying, this is going to be a problem. And the company was warned.
And what was the company's response to that?
When I emailed them about a group I had found where people were posting those photos that Cecilia mentioned of assault rifles, they took them down. But it took me finding that group, and that was on the eve of January 6th. I remember sending that email the night of January 5th for them to take down that particular group. What groups did I not find? What groups did other journalists that work in this space not find? You know, the platform is so big and used by so many people, and Facebook likes to say, oh, we take down 90% of this, or our AI systems catch whatever percentage of that. When you're dealing with millions of posts, 90% is still, you know, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands posts that are online and which are active. And so I think the company often uses its metrics to make people feel like it's safer than it is, when in fact even one really damaging group in which people are orchestrating violence in the Capitol can be too much.
In fact, this touches on Facebook issued some statements after your book has come out. I'd like to read this one to you. This is from Facebook saying, quote, our teams were vigilant in removing content that violated our policies against inciting violence leading up to January 6th. We banned hundreds of militarized social movements, took down tens of thousands of QAnon pages, groups, and accounts from our apps, removed the original Stop the Steal group, labeled candidates' posts that sought to prematurely declare victory, and suspended former President Trump from our platform for at least 2 years. They're saying we did a lot, sometimes more than other companies. How true is that?
Right after the January 6th Capitol riots, Sheryl Sandberg, the chief operating officer, said in an interview, yes, there are some problems on our platform, and we definitely have had some problems with enforcement, but the vast majority of the problems occurred on other platforms. And it actually happens that that was just not the truth, that there was so much organizing that was happening on Facebook, Facebook messaging, and Facebook groups. And we saw that actually in the indictments of many of the people who actually stormed the Capitol later.
So while it is fantastic that they took down that original group, if that original group spurred hundreds of others and those hundreds of others weren't taken down, it begs the question of you know, When can you act? And I mean, how can Facebook sit there as a company and say to the public, we are doing as much as we can, we are being as aggressive as we can? And I wonder, you know, a $1 trillion company, do they have in their possession the metrics to say, right, we need to hire this many content moderators. We don't need to hire 30,000 people on our security team. We need to hire 100,000 people on our security team.
The back of your book has this sort of a sort of humorous way of pointing out this pattern. This is 14 years of mea culpas. We got it. We understand the problems from Sheryl Sandberg and Mark Zuckerberg. Do you get the sense that they really do appreciate that this is an ongoing problem? Or is these mea culpas a sort of kabuki that they go through to keep the regulatory wolves at bay?
The reason why we put those blurbs in the back is because we realize the patterns are what's really powerful. And so the dichotomy is that if they continue to want growth to come first, there will be collateral damage. And so, yes, they do recognize there are problems, and they do try to correct them, but it's always a few steps behind at least.
We know we're at this moment where Congress is debating what to do about these big tech companies. There's complaints coming endlessly. We just heard recently the Surgeon General complaining that social media sites, including Facebook, don't do enough to take down COVID misinformation. When you look forward as to what Congress might do, Shira, is there a sense that there is a solution, that there are things that Congress could do that could help in this regard?
You know, one thing Congress can do is really tackle misinformation head on as its own problem. I think Facebook and a lot of other companies would love to see Congress give them stricter guidelines about what they see as hate speech, what they see as information that leads to voters being disenfranchised. But I really think we're in a moment right now where Congress is struggling with how to define misinformation for itself. There's a lot of energy around antitrust and other ideas, but misinformation, which is difficult because it comes up against our American values of free speech and free expression, that's something they haven't quite been willing to touch yet.
The book is An Ugly Truth, Inside Facebook's Battle for Domination. Shira Frankel and Cecilia Kang, thank you both very much.
Thanks so much.
Thank you for having us.
And on the NewsHour online right now, ahead of the 2020 Olympics opening ceremony, we share 10 things to know about the Tokyo Games. You can find that on Instagram at NewsHour. And that's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. Join us online and again here tomorrow evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Architect, Beekeeper, Mentor, a Raymond James financial advisor, Taylor's advice to help you live your life. Life. Well planned.
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular has been offering no-contract wireless plans designed to help people do more of what they like. Our U.S.-based customer service team can help find a plan that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
Johnson & Johnson. BNSF Railway. The Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And Friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is PBS News Hour West. From WETA Studios in Washington and from our bureau at the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.